Thank you, Laurence, for this amazing Congress one more time. And we would like to present you with Nathalie Baudard, the imaging of normal and pathological prenatal and postnatal maturation of the brain. So to start, I think that it's better to do the prenatal talks in a row, and after Nathalie will talk about the postnatal aspect. To begin, one example, well, this case is an unfortunate case of a little girl, aged of 12 months, who presents a major hypotonia, feeding difficulties, and intellectual retardation. So an MRI is asked. Here is the MRI. You have the MRI of the little girl here, and a normal MRI at her age. And you can see that by regarding the cortical aspect, we can say that this MRI is completely abnormal. Regarding the imaging, the prenatal imaging of this little girl, could we have forecasted this situation? By regarding this ultrasound, could we consider that this aspect in prenatal ultrasound was normal? We're going to try to recognize what is the normal pattern and the abnormal pattern of the cortical aspect in the fetal brain. So, first of all, to recognize the abnormal, we have to know the normal. So, we are going to present the normal gyration. And in the second part, in the second talk, we'll talk about the cortical anomalies. The normal gyration. What is the difference between those three brains, the first one, the second one, and the third one? You can see that the aspect of the foliation is completely different. Fortunately, the first one is the brain of a pig, the second one of a dolphin, and the third one is the human brain. You can see that this brain seems better than the other one, fortunately. Just to understand, the development of the embryo and the differentiation between the neural plate and the neural tube will differentiate it four parts, the forebrain, midbrain, hindbrain, and the spinal cord. And one half part of the pregnancy, the cortex will develop in order to cover the hindbrain. And the second part of the gestation, you have the complete development of the brain, and the major difference is the digging of the different sulci. We have two parts in this the gestation. Between 28 weeks of gestation and after 28 weeks of gestation, the cortical development is mostly related to the neuronal proliferation and the synaptogenesis. And all the steps will form the cortical aspect of the brain. We have the two parts. Sorry, we have these two parts. The first part, you have the brain with just few sulci, as you can see here. And after 25 weeks of gestation, you will have. Sorry. I think I'm going to start the micro on the Mac. So here you have the second part of the gestation, and you can see that the brain is more complex with the gyration. We have three main steps in the development of the neuronal matrix, and Nathalie will talk about that furthermore after. You have this primary step, when you have the proliferation of the cells, in the paraventricular zone, and you will have the migration of the cells towards the cortical plane, to the peripheral part of the brain, and all the cells will be guided by a radial pattern, as you can see here. And all the steps are linked by specific genes. And when you have anomaly on these genes, you will have anomalies on these different steps. As you can see on this histologic view, the periventricular zone is here, just in the middle, and are symmetric, and it is the reserve of the cells. It is a specific zone, and after, all the cells will migrate toward the cortical brain and will develop the different sulci. Here, this aspect of a bound aligning the ventricular structures is very important to know in the fetal brain because it is the reserve of the cells, and during the gestation, this particle aspect will disappear because all the cells will migrate. Let's talk about now the imaging of these different steps and the different sulci. For that, we have ultrasound and MRI. It is very complementary techniques. The more practical imaging is this one, which provide real-time imaging and provide a very high spatial resolution. Whereas the MRI, we don't have the same spatial resolution, but we have a more important high contrast resolution. But it is lower available, and we can't provide any injection in MRI imaging. As you can see here, the evolution of the sulci will remain in the changements of the shape of the sulci. Later you will be on the gestation, and deeper will be all the different sulci with a specific shape, as you can see here. First of all, when you perform ultrasound, it is very important to recognize those three main sulci: the cingulate sulcus, the parieto-occipital fissure, and the calcarine fissure. To understand what is the best way to image those fissures is to understand that you will have a better view of this fissure if you are orthogonal to this fissure. I mean, for example, to correctly visualize the parieto-occipital fissure, you'll have to provide an axial plane to be sure to recognize this fissure, as you can see here on this classical view of the brain of the fetus. Here is the parieto-occipital fissure. This parieto-occipital fissure is important to recognize, to emphasize, because it will be this anatomical landmark which enable the measurement of the ventricle. And to be sure that you have an enlargement of the ventricle, that you have a ventriculomegaly, you will have to provide this axial plane and to put your measure just here, just in front, the parieto-occipital fissure. So that is, it is the first fissure very important to highlight. After, you have the calcarine fissure, and it will be better in the coronal plane to be orthogonal to this fissure, as you can see here. And here you have the calcarine fissure. Here, I don't know if you see the arrow, yes, just here. on the coronal plane. The cingulate fissure, which is sagittal in this plane, as you can see here, will be easier to recognize on the coronal plane, to be orthogonal to this fissure. And you can see here the cingulate fissure, which is very important to have on your report to be sure that the gestation is correct between 20-26 weeks of gestation. As you can see on this diagram, you have an enlargement of the different fissures as long as you go on the gestation. Another very important fissure is the Sylvian fissure. Just pay attention here, because if you are used to recognize it on your daily practice, it will be easier to recognize if it is normal or not when you have the case of pathological anomaly. Here, you have a brain in 23 weeks, and you have this pattern of Sylvian fissure. The coronal plate will offer you a better view of this Sylvian fissure. We have this used with MRI, with postnatal MRI. The coronal view is very important to perform, to see the Sylvian fissure. And with ultrasound, I encourage you to see and to be used to see this type of view, to have the practice of recognize the aspect of the Sylvian fissure. And during the gestation, this fissure will have different shapes and will be enlarged, as you can see here, and will feature different aspects. 22 weeks, you have the U4 here. 27 weeks, you have a quasi-complete digging of this fissure. And 32 weeks, we have the particular shape of T, as you can see here. This term of 28-27 weeks of gestation is very important because it is the turning point of this fissure. It is the moment of when you will be sure that the Sylvian fissure is normal, because she will have this typical shape. As you can see here, before 28 weeks of gestation, ultrasound is sufficiently reliable to assess correctly all the fissures, but after 28 weeks of gestation, MRI will be better. As you can see here, you can have this aspect by ultrasound, but after 28 weeks of gestation, the complexity of all the features will be difficult to provide with the ultrasound. Thanks to the capacity to differentiate gray matter and white matter with MRI, and to have the good differentiation between the cortex and the fluid just around the cortex, MRI will be more reliable to assess a correct gyration. Here you have the evolution of the Sylvian fissure on MRI view, and it is the same aspect that I showed you before with ultrasound, and you can see the progressive digging, the progressive change of the shape of the Sylvian fissure. When you have this pattern, this one, you can be sure that everything is normal. Here, just have a look on the germinal matrix of the periventricular zone, where all the cells are created, and more you will be later you will be under gestation, And you have this aspect which will disappear after the migration of the cells. And when you have the migration of the cells, you will have a more complexity of the different sulci, as you can see here. With MRI, we are able to recognize and to demonstrate the advanced primary sulci. For example, you have the superior temporal sulcus here and the inferior sulcus. And when we interpret MRI, the first thing is to be sure that all the sulci are present and correspond to the term at which one we perform MRI. After 32 weeks of gestation, we'll have inferior temporal fissure, and we'll have the development of secondary and tertiary fissures. What we have to know is that concerning the primary fissures, we have all the same pattern, and we don't have any variation between different people. Concerning the secondary and tertiary fissures, there is a high variability between the different people. So if you are too late in the gestation, you have a very complex aspect of the sulcation, so it will be very difficult to identify all the different sulci. So the best moment to perform MRIs is around 32 weeks of gestation. Here you have an example of an MRI which is performed after 32 weeks of gestation. You can see that you have advanced secondary fissure here, and sometimes it is even difficult to recognize a polymicrogyria, as we can see later, and just tertiary normal fissures. So for fetal MRI and to assess the cortical pattern, we can't do it if it is too early in the pregnancy, and we can't do it if it is too late in the pregnancy because of this variation of all the features. As you can see here, this brain is around 35 weeks of gestation, and you have a lot of different sulci. Nowadays, we have some software which are able to rebuild a fetal brain and to quantify the different sulci. It's not very qualitative, but it is quantitative, and with this software, the machine is able to recognize if the brain fetus is correct and corresponds to the normal term of the gestation. The second part is the pathological gyration. We saw that we have some specific landmarks to recognize that the sulcation is normal. And the gyration could be abnormal. And we have to understand what happens. The main and the main article, which was written by Barkovich, is the key point of this classification. It is the first time that we classified the anomalies of the digression corresponding to the different steps of the migration of the cells. When you have abnormality concerning the proliferation and apoptosis, this anomaly will provide macrocephaly and megalencephaly. When you have an abnormal neuronal migration, these anomalies will provide periventricular heterotopia, lysencephaly, and we have some subtypes of lysencephaly. And when you have anomalies on the cortical plate or on abnormal cortical organization, it will provide polymicrogyria or dysplasia, focal dysplasia. The main thing that is important here is to be able to recognize what is the anomaly. I mean here, this kind of anomaly is called heterotopia, and when you interpret MRI, you have to be able to say that here it is a typical pattern of heterotopia. Concerning the anomalies of lysencephaly, you will have two main anomalies, the pachygyria and the argyria. The pachygyria is a thick aspect of the cortical plate, and the argyria is the complete absence of sulci on the cortical plate. The polymicrogyria is the presence of very small sulci, which are abnormal and which provide an aspect of thick cortical plate, as you can see here, with indented cortical plate. Let's see that by imaging. So here you have the three different steps and the different anomalies which will be related to these different steps. The first one is the abnormal neuronal proliferation. First, let's talk about microcephaly. Microcephaly can be due to acquired cause, I mean infections. It is the main important process. But it can be due to hypoxia or traumatisms. And the genetic cause, which give some microcephalic spectrum and chromosomal syndromes. Here you have a microcephaly with an enlargement of the pericerebral fluid, as you can see here. And what is very important to see here is the presence of the calcification, as you can see here. With MRI, you have this aspect with little sulci, which are not the normal sulci which has to be here at this term. So here, this typical aspect is some anomalies of the cortex, and it's called polymicrogyria. But here you have this microcephaly, and you have this typical profile, as you can see here on the MRI. The entity MCPH, autosomic recessive primary microcephaly, is the microcephaly with no brain obvious anomalies. As you can see here, the Sevian fissure is abnormal, but you have a normal corpus callosum. Here you have a retardation of the digging of the Sevian fissure, as you can see here, but you don't have any other anomalies. And this one was an isolated microcephaly. The prognostic is very bad. There is a mental delay important, as is written. The tuberous sclerosis has this pattern with this hemimegalencephaly. One hemisphere seems bigger than the other one, and this aspect is due to the presence or dysplasia, as you can see here, which means an important thickment of the cortex. Let's talk about the lysencephalia. We saw the anomalies of the proliferation of the cells, and now the anomalies are due to the neuronal migration. And those anomalies will give two types of lesions, as I talked just before. the pachygyria. And what is important is to recognize, to correctly differentiate the anomalies. The pachygyria is this aspect without normal sulci and with this thick cortex, as you can see here. Argyria, you have a less aspect, you have no normal sulci, you have the complete absence of sulci, as you can see here. And it will be the main signs to talk about lissencephaly. The diagnosis of the different types of lissencephaly is not so important in prenatal field. You have to describe correctly the anomalies, and after, with the neuropediatrician, the obstetricians, we'll think about specific diagnosis, but we know if you describe pachygyria or argyria, that the prognostic will be bad anyway. But it is better to know the different type of lissencephaly, and we know that the two main classical is LIS1 and XLIS. Here you have the aspect of LIS1, and it was the diagnosis for the little girl that I presented just at the beginning of the talk, with a thick corpus callosum, as you can see. And with MRI, you have this typical pattern of brain in 8 shape. You can put an 8 on this brain, and you can see, and what is important to recognize, is that you have a gradient. You have a more severe pattern in the posterior part of the brain, because here you have quite a complete absence of sulci, and here you have just here, just our normal sulci. Here you have the coronal view of this LIS1 with this typical aspect of lissencephaly with argyria and pachygyria. Here a postnatal view, but Nathalie will talk about that in a few minutes. We have other types of lissencephaly, the DCX mutation, and the XLIS has not the 8 aspect, but this particle pattern of double cortex, as you can see here, with a thickened cortex. Here you have this aspect and the postnatal correlation just here. We have other lissencephaly as Walker-Warburg, and Walker-Warburg is correctly diagnosed when you have this typical shape of Z, as you can see here, and the very important ventriculomegaly, which is diagnosed early in the pregnancy. Here you have on the MRI the typical Z shape, as you can see here, with the important ventriculomegaly. When you have lissencephaly, when you recognize argyria or pachygyria, you have to check the midline, obviously, and you have to check all the other abnormality on the fetus. And when you have lissencephaly with corpus callosum agenesia, with genital organs anomaly, as you can see here, you have to think about the X-Lax syndrome, which is particular. You can have heterotopia, and heterotopia, it is this particular aspect here with little nodules in hyposignal T2 lining the ventricle here. And when you have all this aspect with this squared aspect of the ventricle horns, and when you have an enlargement of the posterior fossa, you have to think about the filamin A. But one more time, the most important thing is not to do the definitive diagnosis, but to be able to recognize correctly all the anomalies or the morphological anomalies. Here you have another example of heterotopia. The third phenomenon, and the third anomaly is when you have the cortical plate, which is disorganized. Here, you have a CMV infection, and with the ultrasound, the first thing that was surprising is that you have, at the term of 32 weeks of gestation, an enlargement of the fluid, pericerebral fluid, as you can see here. And when you have this aspect, you have to be very careful. You have to think about the possibility of polymicrogyria. And by performing MRI, you can validate, you can see that you have an abnormal aspect of the cortex, which was polymicrogyria. When you have this aspect with macrocephalia and with this abnormal cortex, as you can see here, it is important to provide MRI, and MRI confirmed that you have a macrocephalia with abnormalities of the cortex that you can see here, with all these little sulci, with this indented aspect of the cortex, which is typical of polymicrogyria. And when you have a bilateral polymicrogyria in a macrocephalia, you can suspect that you have a metabolic disease as the Zellweger syndrome. One more time, the most important is not to say here we are sure that we have a Zellweger. No, the most important thing is to recognize that you don't have the normal sulci. You have a thickened aspect of the cortex with little sulci, and the most important is to suppose and to assume that you have polymicrogyria. Another example, it was pregnancy with TTTS, and here you have an enlargement of the periventricular space, and here it was the probability that you have an abnormality of the cortex, and for sure you can see that with MRI, you have here the typical aspect of polymicrogyria, and here it was due to ischemia, which was the etiology of the polymicrogyria. So just to conclude, the thing important is to recognize early on the normal aspect of the brain with the normal sulci, and you have to practice with the ultrasound to recognize the normal primary fissure, to be sure to be aware when you have a normal fissure that you have to refer, you have to perform MRI. It is important to know that MRI will be more reliable after 26-20 weeks of gestation to have a good assessment of the sulcation. It is important to recognize the simple microcephalia and the microlissencephaly by the assessment of argyria and pachygyria. And the genetic, it is the key point, but we are not able prenatally to perform correctly genetic searching. So let's talk about the postnatal aspect with Nathalie.